David, the language out of the Bank of Canada recently characterizes this recent contraction as a recession. Even as the bank expanded asset purchases to include a provincial bond buying program, the governor did not call it quantitative easing. I'm wondering how you would describe it. How would you characterize it?
Well, firstly, there's no question that the whole world is in a huge recession that is going to be infinitely worse than what we had in 2008, 2009, notwithstanding the fact that the causes are different. This is actually a little more complicated. At least we figured out last time that we just had to ring fence the banks and not nationalize them, not have them fail with TARP 2, and we were then off to the races. A health crisis that morphs into an economic crisis and then into a financial crisis. I mean, this is just something that we haven't seen before. You know, we have actually seen runs on banks before, like we did in 08 and 09. We just didn't have the appropriate policy response for it. But we don't have a big sample size for what's happening right now to really evaluate. So what caught me today, back to your answer on the Bank of Canada, was they almost looked to me like a classic S&P 500 company that's releasing results today, but not providing any guidance because we're just forecasting in a bog. Normally, the bank would give us specific numbers on their economic forecast, both domestically and globally. And here they're telling us, you know, ranges of, you know, for the second quarter between 15 and 30%, which you can drive a Mack truck through. But just even if we get, I mean, we're in a situation now where even if we get to the bank scenario, the best part of it, which is the 15 and not the 30, that still is almost a, what you would classify as a depression-like economic plunge, even the best case scenario. I think what we're really left here is that we don't really know beyond this shock what the recovery path is going to look like. And the central banks don't know, and no economists really know. You just have to develop scenarios, which we're all doing. But what you don't know is how to allocate what the probabilities are going to be of each scenario developing. The one thing I can tell you is that all the people that were banking on a V-shaped recovery coming to the fore, well, those expectations have certainly been obliterated over the course of the past few weeks.
The IMF has recently said that Canada's economy will collapse to the tune of 6.2% this year. I'm wondering, with all that the fiscal authorities have been doing, what's left? What ammo is left? Because it seems like this is not stimulus for growth. It's just simply to keep our head above water.
Well, you know, it's a great question. I mean, the first question is, has enough been done in terms of dollars and cents between fiscal and monetary policy to deal with a 6% collapse in GDP? And frankly, I'm not really so sure that we're there yet. I mean, what the Bank of Canada did today was really just to, when you think about it, address liquidity issues. Maybe you could argue that the bank moved today to redress financial stress issues. And so you would say, well, okay, well, provincial bond spreads should come in and investment grade corporate bond spreads should come in. So that alleviates stress, but doesn't generate anything in the way of economic activity. And I'd say the same thing in the United States, who've gone a lot further on fiscal policy. And I would say that the government of Canada should go a lot further on fiscal policy. And I would tend to agree with you that really what's happened so far is you would term as income replacement. That's what the governments are trying to do here, is do their best to ensure that that personal incomes or even corporate, say, incomes are not going to be seriously impaired because of this health shock that's morphed into the governments telling us that we're in lockdown mode. The problem I see, especially in the Canadian context, is that the dollars being put into the system to make people whole just aren't there. So if you're going to ask me, I think that the ceiling is really unforecastable. I would say that we need a lot more government stimulus to get through this. I think that direct payments, and it would have to be blanket payments. I don't think that you can even means test this sort of thing without incurring tremendous delays. And it could incur some moral hazard and the money gets in the wrong hands. But this is a time where if it's not done right, if a floor is not put under this economic collapse, and we don't see this government transfer to the private sector, at least for a temporary period, it's going to not just mean that the recession gets worse in the near term, but it's also going to impair the inevitable recovery is going to be a lot weaker too. So I would tend to agree with you that now is the time for much more radical fiscal action on the part of Ottawa.
In terms of the floor, Goldman Sachs has been saying that it's hardly unlikely that stocks will see another low. You haven't quite been bearish or bullish. I'm wondering what your position is.
Well, actually, I've been pretty bearish on the stock market for some time. And I was saying that when you stripped out, you know, the FANG stocks and the reality that we have technology in the S&P 500, reaching 26% of the index, historically high, we're almost back into this Nortel mentality back in, 1998, 99, 2000. And so I was saying for a long time, even before the crisis, that this was a market that was being carried along by a handful of mega cap blue chip stocks. And of course, there's been this massive drive into equity ETFs. And when you're buying the ETFs, you're buying the index. So every dollar going into these ETFs are being devoted increasingly towards a handful of stocks. It became so concentrated. So I was saying even heading into the peak in February, this was actually not a very healthy market in terms of how lopsided it was. When you look at the equal-weighted S&P and the cap-weighted S&P, there was a huge divergence. When you looked at the small caps, for example, the S&P 500 is one index. Let's look at the small caps, which actually is the heartbeat of the U.S. economy. They were not making new highs. They were well off the highs, even as the large caps were making new highs into mid-February. So I had been actually pounding my fist on the table about this market and how uneven it was for some time. Then we get a situation where we have a recession. We came into this. Portfolio managers, incredibly, had only 2% cash. Cash-to-asset ratio had never been as low going into recession. Companies had no cash. We certainly know in Canada that household savings rates were bumping against the floor. Liquidity was just a dirty word. Who wanted liquidity? And so that was a big problem here. But the reality is that we had the initial collapse in the stock market. It priced in a recession. And then we had the big snapback in light of all the stimulative measures taken by the Fed and Congress and the Treasury. It was a classic bear market rally. And so my view here is that, the price earnings multiple on 2021 earnings, of course, the bulls will all tell you, well, we have to look at normalized earnings. Okay, I'll grant you that. On 2021 consensus earnings, as of yesterday's close, the PE multiple was back to 16, where it was at the end of January. So again, in answer to your question roundabout way, I'm still bearish. If you're going to ask me, do I think that we will see the recent lows on March 23rd undercut? I firmly believe that. I think we're not through this by a long shot. I think that people have believed that this is a short and sharp recession, and that we're back to a big recovery in the third quarter. And I don't think that's going to happen. I think there's an equal risk that actually the economy doesn't recover in the third quarter. And I'm not going to tell people when there's going to be a recovery, but nothing is back to normal until we either get an effective treatment or we get a vaccine. And that could be many months away. So my sense is that the multiple in the stock market is not priced for a very weak recovery, even after we get through the second quarter detonation. And I think that's the base case view. The base case view is not a V-shaped recovery. The base case view is not even a left-handed check mark. It's really going to be a recovery that is going to be a string of what I say is smaller case W's, and the market's not priced for that.
as governments on both sides of the border roll out these aid packages, we can expect deficits to surge. And there's only so much that governments can print. Where does the US dollar go from here? Where does the loonie go from here?
Well, you know, the answer to the second question is a lot easier. The Canadian dollar just over 140. I mean, I think it's going to go to 150 or even worse. I think that Canada went into this situation in far worse shape than most other countries. We have household debt ratios amongst the highest in the world. In fact, the household debt to income ratio in Canada is infinitely higher than it was at the credit bubble peak back in 07 in the United States. You know, we lament about corporate debt ratios in the U.S., you know, being at a record high 50%, while in Canada 75%. So as we always talk about the federal government balance sheet in Canada being in good shape, the rest of the market, including provinces, and especially the private sector, are incredibly bad shape. The debt situation here is pretty dire. That is going to hold back the recovery. On top of that, Canada is a small open economy, and this is a severe global recession. So we're going to get the added hit from the fact that we have a very high export orientation. And then, of course, what the implications are of this global demand hit on oil prices and what that's going to mean for the energy sector here, which was already in dire straits before the crisis even took hold. So the shocks in Canada are magnified by very poor private sector balance sheets, by what's happening in energy, and also by the fact that we're going to get caught in the cross currents, not just of declining domestic demand here, but declining foreign demand. The one thing about the United States is that they are a large closed economy. Things are going to be very rough there, but by less so in Canada compared to Canada. So I think the Canadian dollar is going to be fundamentally weak. I'd be selling into the rallies that we've been seeing, which are just technical in nature. And as far as the U.S. dollar is concerned, you know, you would say, well, ordinarily, with the money supply going up 20% at an annual rate, and the Fed buying everything in sight, and jeopardizing the sanctity of the balance sheet for the world's reserve currency, you'd probably think, well, you know, how could the U.S. dollar be going up? But again, exchange rates are a pair trade. So you've got other things going on in other parts of the world. I think that the forecasts for the UK economy now, especially with Brexit, far worse than they are in the United States. If you really want to own sterling against anything, the euro right now, which has not got its act together to develop a common coronavirus bond, especially to help out the really dilapidated and very weak economic and financial regions, specifically Italy. And if you see what's happening in Italy, there's tremendous anti-EU sentiment going on right now, which looks a lot like Greece did back 7-8 years ago. So are you going to be bullish on the euro? Like, what currency will you be bullish on against the U.S. dollar? And so it's almost, you know, as if the U.S. dollar can come out of this as, you know, the smartest kid in summer school, you know, assuming that we end up seeing summer school this summer. I think maybe, you know, if I had to craft the answer, it would be, which currency do you want to own globally? And maybe you want to own the currency that is no government's liability and something that the central banks can't magically just produce out of thin air, and it's gold. And gold is broken out in every currency terms, and actually that is the currency you want to own in the portfolio.